Welcome to Living Life. Today we're going to walk into the 1 Corinthians chapter 14 that discuss about the tongue issues. And it's very important that how that we interpret this passage. And I remember that in our church, in the Onuri Church in Seoul, Korea, is that we have a morning services, and we have one woman that she always pray in tongues very, very loud, so that it's very disturbing to other people, and other people asked me to go and tell her. And then we had a kind of argument that she claims that the speaking tongues is a speaking spirit and all kind of other things that she have mentioned. But then that's what the Apostle Paul in the book of Corinthians, they had the same problem, I think. And that's what we're going to discuss, and may the instruction and the word of God will give you insight how to speak in tongues and what is the tongue about in the book.
First Corinthians 14, verses 13 to 25. For this reason, anyone who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret what he says. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. So what shall I do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will also pray with my mind. I will sing with my spirit, but I will also sing with my mind. If you are praising God with your spirit, how can one who finds himself among those who do not understand say Amen to your thanksgiving, since he does not know what you are saying? You may be giving thanks well enough, but the other man is not edified. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. But in the church, I would rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. Brothers, stop thinking like children. In regard to evil, be infants, but in your thinking, be adults. In the law it is written, through men of strange tongues and through the lips of foreigners, I will speak to this people. But even then they will not listen to me, says the Lord. Tongues, then, are a sign, not for believers but for unbelievers. Prophecy, however, is for believers, not for unbelievers. So if the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues, and some who do not understand or some unbelievers come in, will they not say that you are out of your mind? But if an unbeliever or someone who does not understand comes in while everybody is prophesying, he will be convinced by all that he is a sinner and will be judged by all. And the secrets of his heart will be laid bare. So he will fall down and worship God, exclaiming, God is really among you.
As we discussed the 1 Corinthians chapter 14, is that Apostle Paul is continuously speaking about the problem with the tongue. And there is a certain things that I learned in during the seminary that this passage here that mentions different kind of tongues, and that we have to realize that the Greek word of a tongue is, could be interpreted as a glossai, which means language. As you know that in the life of Apostle Paul, that he spoke Latin, he spoke Hebrew, he spoke Greek, and he spoke all these languages. And also that the book of Corinthians it mentions about this tongue, is that sometimes is that have a different connotation about the tongue. And also that we have to realize that the situation in the church of Corinth is that was the first church that is a group out of Gentiles. You know, some of the church, during the first the mission journey of Paul, that he mostly spoke to the Jewish people and people that he was some kind of Jewish lineage. But then in the book of Corinthians, is always Hellenistic background and is a Gentile. So that they did not have any religious background, and he's teaching one by one. And many people that who was in the book, in the church of Corinth, is that they spoke different languages. Probably they spoke Latin, they spoke Greek, and different languages from different places. So is that when they prayed together, and probably you could hear in the different languages. Myself is that when I go to Los Angeles, is that the first moment that I go to the airport, I start hearing different languages. Like I was raised up and in South America, is that all of a sudden is that you hear the Spanish language, and then you hear the English, and then sometimes it's a Korean. So it's very, very confusing. And that's what he's saying, is that Apostle Paul is teaching us, I do pray in tongues. That means that I do pray in the two language, is which is he could pray it in Greek or Latin or in Hebrew, but then also he prayed in the spiritual language. What he says here is by giving the utterance of the Spirit, and he does not discourage us speaking tongues, because he says that I speak in tongues more than any of you. But then one thing that he talks about is that a couple of things that he mentions about is that it's better to prophesize than speaking tongue. And other thing that he says is better speak five sentences that it makes sense than speaking an unknown language or in tongues. That's what he's teaching us today, is that, you know, is that in the church, we should encourage, we should edify, and we should help each other, and we should communicate. Major things in the church today is that we do not communicate. It's don't let the tongue issue hinder your spirituality. Don't let the tongue issue hinder your salvation theology. Don't let the tongues issue brings the barrier between your brothers and sisters. And those kind of things that this Apostle Paul is teaching. And after all, he's talking about the gift of prophecy. He said, prophecy is more beneficial, because when the new believers come to the church, they say, hey, he's speaking in a language that we don't understand. And maybe he's crazy or something, because when you speak in a spiritual language, there's always blabbing about things. Or maybe on other books, that maybe the guy is drunk, because Book of Acts, that's what he's saying, when the people start speaking in tongues. So therefore is that Apostle Paul is saying that he does not want to bring a confusion. I mean, even though you are living in a culture of the diversity, but the ones to bring the unity. How? With the love, with the Christ, with the emphasis upon that how Jesus Christ died for us, and Jesus Christ died for our sins, and how the Jesus Christ came to our life in flesh, and he suffered with us so that we can participate the eternal glory that he has bestowed upon our life. That's most important than either whether we should speak in tongue or not. The prophecy should come, hey, God is a living God. Jesus Christ was raised among the dead. Now he's that he sits in the right hand of the throne of God, and is giving the hope and the love and the faith that is entailed in our in community, in our church, in our life. That's what is important. The tongue issue is that something that we discuss about it, but then it's not more important than prophecy. It's not more important than what Jesus Christ then did for our life. It's not more important than love of God that we should bestow from brothers and sisters. In Korea, a lot of people, they like to be prayed over, and in Korea, a lot of people believe in impartation, and a lot of people that who prays for the people, they speak in tongue, and then they interpret themselves that this is with the will of God. And sometimes you hear some of the saying that the God told me so, and after speaking in tongues. But I don't think that's edifying in the church, because is that, you know, number one is if it's God's willing to tell you, probably will tell to other people as well. And also is that the speaking in tongue, that the unknown language, is that sometimes that you cannot understand. And then it's God is God and not confusion. God is not God of confusion. God is God is... He's God that is able to encourage us. He's God that gives empower us. He's God that gives us a love such way that we can walk into a body of Christ with the unity. That's what the God is saying. Is that the speaking in tongue is your issue? Do not be concerned about it, because it is a gift of God. And not everybody has the same gift. Probably you could have better gift than tongues. You know, gift is not a sign of salvation at all. And the gift is just a gift of God so that you are able to edify to yourself, not to others. That's what he's saying. And may the word of God encourage you, empower you, and bring this confusion about tongues into your life such way that if you have speaking tongues, say, God, I thank you so that you give me a gift. So if you don't speak in tongues, ask God, and God will give you according to his will. And that not necessarily that you said, you know, if I speak in tongues, I have a salvation. It's not at all. That's not it. Okay, let's pray. Father, and as Apostle Paul says, that he speaks in tongues, and also that he speaks in a different languages in order to preach the gospel, in order to prophecy of God, of kingdom of God to the people, Father. And I ask you to don't let the issue of the tongues confuse people, as well as that distorts the doctrine of God in the days of our life. And I ask you to thank you for the gift of tongue, and also that if I don't have a gift, I ask you to give it to us, and also is that don't let us to hinder or dread you or fear about because of the unable to speak in tongues, because love is a supreme, love is a powerful, is much powerful than just the gift of tongues. Thank you for your grace again, Lord, and I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.